honoured Lancaster. Hast thou, according to thy oath and command, brought hither Henry Hereford, thy bold son, here to make good the boisterous late appeal, which then our leisure would not let us hear, against the Duke of Norfolk, Thomas Mowbray?
I have, my liege.
And hast thou sounded him, if he appeal the Duke on ancient mass, or worthily, as a good subject should, on some known ground of treachery in him?
As near as I could sift him on that argument, and some apparent danger seen in him, aimed at your highness, no inveterate man.
Then call him to our presence, face to face, and frowning brow to brow, ourselves will hear the accuser and the accused freely speak. High-stomached are they both, and full of ire. Enraged, deaf as the sea, hasty as fire.
Many years of happy days befall my gracious sovereign, my most loving liege.
Each day still better others' happiness, unto the heavens, envying Earth's good hap, adding immortal title to your crown.
We thank you both. Yet one but flatters us, as well appeareth by the cause you come, namely to appeal each other of high treason. Cousin of Hereford, what dost thou object against the Duke of Norfolk, Thomas Mowbray?
First heaven be the record to my speech. In the devotion of a subject's love, tendering the precious safety of my prince, and free from other misbegotten hate, come I appellant to this princely presence. Now, Thomas Mowbray, do I turn to thee, and mark my greeting well, for what I speak, my body shall make good upon this earth, or my divine soul answer it in heaven. Thou art a traitor and a miscreant, too good to be so, and too bad to live, since the more fair and crystal is the sky, the uglier seem the clouds that in it fly.
Let not my cold words here accuse my zeal. First the fair reverence of your highness curbs me from giving reins and spurs to my free speech, which else would post until it had returned these terms of treason, doubled down his throat. Setting aside his high notoriety, and that it be no kinsman to my liege, I did defy him, and I spit at him, call him a slanderous coward, and a bit
hair trembling coward! There! I throw my liege, disclaiming I hear the kindred of the king, and lay aside my high blood's loyalty, which fear, not reverence, makes thee to accept.
Take it up, and by that sword I swear, which gently lay my mitre on my shoulder, I answer thee, in any fair degree, a chivalrous design of knightly pride, and when I meant alive, may I not light, if I be traitor or unjustly fight.
What doth our cousin lay to Mowbray's charge? It must be great that can inherit us so much as of a fault of ill in him.
Look what I speak. My life shall prove it true, that Mowbray hath received 8,000 nobles in name of lending for your highest soldiers, the which he hath detained for lewd employments, like a false traitor and injurious villain. Besides, I say, and will in battle prove, that all the treasons for these 18 years, compounded and contrived in this land, fetched from false Mowbray that first head and spring. Further, I say, and further will maintain upon his bad life to make all this good, that he did plot our uncle Gloucester's death, sluiced out his innocent soul through streams of blood, which blood, like sacrificing Abel's cries, even from the tongueless caverns of the earth, to me, for justice and rough chastisement, and by the glorious worth of my descent, this arm shall do it, or this life be spent.
How high a pitch his resolution soars! Thomas of Norfolk, what sayst thou to this?
Oh, let my sovereign turn away his face, and bid his ears a little while be deaf, till I have told this slander of his blood, how God and good men hate so foul a liar.
Mowbray, impartial are our eyes and ears. Were he my brother, nay, my kingdom's heir, as he is but my father's brother's son. Now by my scepter's awe I make a vow, such neighbour nearness to our sacred blood should nothing privilege him, nor partial eyes, the unstooping firmness of my upright soul. He is our subject, Mowbray, so free speech and fearless I to thee allow.
Then, Bolingbroke, as well as to thy heart, through the false passage of thy throat thou liest. 3 parts of that receipt I had for Callus, his first eye duly to his highness soldier. The other part reserved I, by consent, for that my sovereign leave was in my debt upon remainder of a dear account since last I went to France to fetch his queen. Now, swallow down that knot. For Gloucester's death, I slew him not, but to my own disgrace neglected my sworn duty in that case. This is my fault. As for the rest of the ill, it issued from the rancor of a villain, a recreant, and most degenerate traitor, which in myself I boldly will defend, and interchangeably hurl down my gage upon this overweening traitor's foot, to prove myself a liar, gentlemen, even in the best blood chamber in his bosom. In haste, peril, most heartily I pray your highness to assign our trial there.
Ralph Kindled, gentlemen, be ruled by me. Let's purge this collar without letting blood. This we prescribe, though no physician. Deep malice makes too deep incision. Forget, forgive, conclude, and be agreed. Our doctors say this is no month to bleed.
Good uncle, let this anger be gone. We'll come to Duke of Norfolk, you yourself.
To be a made peace shall become my age. Throw down my son, the Duke of Norfolk's gage.
And Norfolk throw down his.
When, Harry, when obedience bids, I should not bid again.
Norfolk throw down, we bid. There is no
brute. Myself, my thrall, dread sovereign at thy foot. My life thou shalt command, but not my shame. Disgraced, impeached, and baffled here, pierced to the soul with slander's venom spear, of which no balm can cure but his heart blood which breathed this poison.
Rage must be withstood. Give me his gage.
Lions make leopards tame!
They would not change his spots.
Take but my shame and I resign my gage.
You dear, dear lord, the purest treasure mortal times afford is spotless reputation.
Thought away men of a gilded loam or painted clay.
A jewel in a 10 times barred up chest is a bold spirit in a loyal breast. Cousin, throw down your games. Do you begin?
O God, defend my soul from such deep sin. Shall I seem crestfallen in my father's sight?
We were not born to sue, but to command! Which since we cannot do to make you friends, be ready as your lives shall answer it, at Coventry upon St. Lambert's Day. There shall your swords and lances arbitrate the swelling difference of your settled hate.
Entitled patience is pale cold cowardice in noble breasts. What should I say? To safeguard thine own life, the best way is to avenge my Gloucester's death.
God's is the quarrel. For God's substitute, his deputy, anointed in his sight, hath caused his death. The which, if wrongfully, let heaven revenge. For I may never lift an angry arm against his minister.
Oh, where then, alas, may I complain myself?
To God, the widow's champion and defence.
Why then, I will. Farewell, old God. Thou goest to Coventry, there to behold our cousin Hereford and fell Mowbray fight. Oh, sit my husband's wounds on Hereford's spear, that it may enter butcher Mowbray's breast. Farewell, old God. Thy sometimes brother's wife with her companion grief must end her life.
Sister, farewell. I must to Coventry. As much good stay with thee as go with me.
Commend me to thy brother Edmund York. Bid him. Oh, what? With all good speed and flashy visit me. Alack, and much of good old York there see. But empty lodgings and unfurnished walls, unpeopled offices, untrodden stones. And what here there for welcome but my groans? Desolate. Desolate will I hence and die, and the last leave of thee takes my weeping eye.
Champions are prepared and stay for nothing but his majesty's approach.
The marshal demand of yonder champion the cause of his arrival here in arms.
In God's name and the king's, say who thou art, and why thou comest to us knightly clad in arms. Against what man comest thou, and what thy quarrel? Speak truly of thy knighthood and thy oath, and so defend thee heaven and thy valour.
My name is Thomas Norbury, Duke of Norfolk, and a common age by my oath, which thou defend the knight's fire. Both to defend my loyalty and truth to God, my king, and my succeeding issue against the Duke of Hereford that appeals me, and by the grace of God and this my arm to prove him in defending of myself a traitor to my God, my king, and me. And as I truly fight defending him.
Marshal, ask yonder knight in arms both who he is and why he cometh hither.
What's your name? See, what's that pardon? Speak like true knight.
Harry of Hereford, Lancaster, and Derby, man. We ready here you stand in arms to prove by God's grace and my body's valour. Enlist Sir Thomas Mowbray, Duke of Norfolk, that he is a villain, foul and dangerous, to God of Heaven, King Richard, and to me. And as I truly fight, defend me.
In God's name and the king's, on pain of death, let no man be so bold or daring hardy as to touch the lists, except the marshal and such officers appointed to direct these fair designs.
Oh, Marshal, let me kiss my sovereign's hand and bend my knee before his majesty. For Mowbray and myself are our two men who vow a long and weary pilgrimage.
Dependent in all duty greets her highness, and great to kiss her hand and take his leave.
We will descend and fold him in our arms. Cousin of Hereford, as thy cause is right, so be thy fortune in this royal fight. Farewell, my blood, which if today thou shed, lament me may, but not revenge thee dead.
Oh, let no noble eye profane a tear for me if I be gored with Mowbray's spear. My loving lord, I take my leave of you. Of you, my noble cousin, Lord of Earl, who bow, the earthly author of my blood, whose youthful spirit in me regenerate, doth with a twofold vigour lift me up, and furbish you the name of John Cork, even in the lusty behaviour of a son.
God, in thy good cause, make thee prosperous. Be swift like lightning in the execution, and let thy blows doubly redoubled fall like amazing thunder on the cast of thy adverse pernicious enemy. Rouse up thy youthful blood, be valiant, and live.
However glad our fortunes has, my love,
there lives or dies true to King Richard's crown, a loyal, just, and upright gentleman.
Farewell, my lord. Security I espy, virtue with valour captured in thine eye. Order the trial, Marshal, and begin.
Sound trumpets and set forward combatants.
Plucked four away,
6 frozen winters spent, return with welcome home from banishment.
How long a time lies in one little word? 4 lagging winters and 4 wanton springs end in a word. Such is the breath of kings.
I thank my liege that in regard of me he shortens 4 years of my son's exile. But little advantage shall I reap thereby. For ere the 6 years that he hath to spend can change their moods and bring their times about, my oil-dried lamp will time be wasted, light shall be extinct with age and endless night.
Why, uncle, thou hast many years to live.
But not a minute, king, that thou canst give. Shorten my days thou canst with sullen sorrow, and pluck nights from me, but not lend the morrow.
Thy son is banished upon good advice, whereto thy tongue a parting verdict gave. Why at our justice seest thou men to now?
Things sweet to taste seem indigestion sour. You urge me as a judge, but I had rather you would have bid me argue like a father. Oh, had it been a stranger, not my child, to smooth his fault, I should have been more mild.
Cousin, farewell, and uncle, bid him so. 6 years we banish him, and he shall go.
Cousin, farewell. What presence must not know? From where you do remain, let paper show.
Oh, to what purpose dost thou hoard thy words that thou returnst no greeting to thy friends?
I have too few to take my leave of you, when the tongue's office should be prodigal to breathe the abundant dolor of the heart.
Thy grief is but thy absence for a time. What are 6 winters? They are quickly gone. Teach thy necessity to reason thus. There is no virtue like necessity. Think not the king did banish thee, but thou the king. Look what thy soul holds here. Imagine it to lie that way thou goest, not whence thou comest. For gnarling sorrow hath less power to bite the man that mocks at it and sets it right.
Who can hold a fire in his hand by thinking of the frosty Caucasus? Or wallow naked in December snow by thinking of fantastic summer's heat? No. The apprehension of the good gives but the greater feeling to the worst. Fell sorrow's tooth doth never rankle more than when he bites, but lanceth not the sword.
Come, my son, I bring thee on thy way. Had I thy youth and cause, I would not stay.
Sweet soil, adieu. My mother and my nurse, who bears me yet.
I saw from Bushy, Bagot here in green, observed his courtship to the common people, how he did seem to dive into their hearts with humble and familiar courtesy. Off goes his bonnet to an oyster wench. A brace of draymen bid God speed him well, and had the tribute of his supple mien. With thanks, my countrymen,
my loving friends, as were our country in reversion his, and he our subject's next degree in hope.
Well, he is gone, and with him go these laws. Now for the rebels which stand out in Ireland, expedient manage must be made, my liege, if further leisure yield them further means, for their advantage and your highness love.
We will ourselves in person to this woman, and for our coffers with too great a court, and liberal our guests on ground somewhat light, we are enforced to farm our royal realm. The revenue whereof shall furnish us for our affairs in hand. If that comes short, our substitutes at home shall have blank charters, whereto when they shall know what men are rich, they shall subscribe them for large sums of gold, and send them after to supply our wants, for we will make for Ireland presently. Bushy, what news?
Old John of Gaul is grievous sick, my lord, suddenly taken, and hath sent post haste to entreat your majesty to visit him.
Come, gentlemen, let's all go visit him. Pray God we may make haste and come too late.
Built by nature for herself against infection and the hand of war. This happy breed of men, this little world, this precious stone set in the silver sea, which serves it in the office of a wall, or as a moat defensive to a house, against the envy of less happier lands. Blessed plot. This earth, this realm, this England, this mercy, this teeming womb of royal kings, feared by their breed and famous by their birth, this land of such dear souls, this dear, dear land, dear for her reputation through the world, is now leased out, I die pronouncing it, like to a tenement or pelting farm. England, bound in with the triumphant sea, whose rocky shore beats back the envious siege of watery Neptune, is now bound in with shame, with inky blots and rotten parchment bonds. Will the scandal vanish with my life?
The king is come.
Deal mildly with his youth, for young hot coats being rage to rage the more.
What comfort, man? How is it with aged Gaunt?
Oh, how that name befits my composition. Old Gaunt indeed, and Gaunt being old. Within me grief have kept a tedious fast, and who abstains from meat that is not gone? For sleeping England long time have I watched, watching breeds leanness, leanness is all gone. The pleasure that some fathers read upon is my fixed fast, and I am in my children's books, and therein fasting hast thou made me long.
Can sick men play so nicely with their names?
Oh, misery makes sport to mock itself. Since thou dost seek to kill my name and me, I mock my name, great king, to flatter thee.
Should dying men flatter with those that live?
Men living flatter those that die.
Thou now diest, save thou flatterest me.
Oh, thou diest, though I deceiver be.
I am in health, I breathe and see thee ill.
Oh, he that made me knows I see thee ill. Thy deathbed is no lesser than thy land, wherein thou liest in reputation sick. And thou, too careless patient as thou art, commits thy anointed body to the cure of those physicians that first wounded thee. A thousand flatterers sit within thy crown, whose compass is no bigger than thy head, and yet, encaged in so small a verge, the waste is no bit lesser than thy land. Oh, have thy grandsire with a prophet's eye seen how his son's son shall destroy his sons? From forth I meet you and blame thy shame, deposing thee before thou wert possessed, which art possessed now to depose thyself. Landlord of England art thou now, not king. Thy state of law is bondslave to the law, and thou...
A lunatic, lean, wicked fool! Presuming on an ague's privilege, darest with thy frozen admonition make pale our cheek, chasing the royal blood with fury from his native residence. Now by my seat's right royal majesty, wert thou not brother to great Edward's son, this tongue that runs so roundly in thy head should run thy head from thy unreverend shoulders.
Oh, spare thee not my brother Edward's son, for thou I was his father Edward's son. The blood already like a pelican hast thou tapped out and drunkenly caroused. My brother Gloucester, plain, well-meaning soul, whom fair befallen heaven amongst happy souls, may be a precedent and witness good that thou respect'st not spilling Edward's blood. Join with the present sickness that I have, and thy unkindness be like crooked age to crop at once a too long withered flower. Live in thy shame, but die not shame with thee. These words hereafter thy tormentors be.
Convey me to my bed, then to my grave. Love they to live, and love that honor may.
And let them die that age and sullens have, for both us thou and both become the grave.
Words to wayward sickliness and age in him. He loves you on my life and holds you dear, as Harry Duke of Hereford were he here.
Right, you say true, as Hereford's love, so his, as theirs, so mine, and all be as it is.
My liege Lord Gaunt commends him to your majesty.
What says he?
Nay, nothing. All is said. His tongue is but a stringless instrument. Words, life, and all Lord Lancaster had spent.
Be York the next that must be bankrupt, so. Though death be poor, it ends a mortal war.
The ripest fruit first falls, and so doth he. His time. So much for that. Now for our Irish wars, we must supplant those rough, rug-headed kerns, which live like Ben and Werner Venom House, but only they have privilege to live. And for these great affairs to ask some charge, towards our assistance we do seize to us the plate, corn, revenues, and movables whereof our uncle Gault did stand possessed.
How long shall I be patient? Ah! How long shall tender duty make me suffer wrong? Not Gloucester's death, nor Hereford's banishment, nor Gault's rebukes, nor England's private wrongs have ever made me sour my patient cheek, nor been one wrinkle of my sovereign's faith. I am the last of noble Edward's sons, of whom thy father, Prince of Wales, was first. His face thou hast, for even so looked he, accomplished with the number of thy arms. But when he frowned, it was against the French, and not against his friends. Oh, Richard, York is too far gone with grief, or else he never would compare between...
Why, uncle, what's the matter?
Oh, my liege, seek you to seize and gripe into your hands the royalties and rights of banished Hereford? Is not God dead? And doth not Hereford live? Was not God just, and is not Harry true? Did not the one deserve to have an heir? Is not his heir a well-deserving son? Take Hereford's rights away, and take from Tyne his charters and his customary rights. Let not tomorrow then ensue today. Be not thyself a hobgoblin a king, but by fair sequence and substantia. Now a fool God, God forbid I say true. If you do wrongfully seize Hereford's rights, you pluck 1,000 dangers on your head. You lose 1,000 well-disposed hearts, and prick my tender patience to those thoughts which honor and allegiance cannot think.
Think what you will, we seize into our hands his plate, his goods, his money, and his lands.
I love me by the wine, my liege. Farewell. What will ensue hereof, there's none can tell.
Go, Bushy, to the Earl of Wiltshire Strait. Bid him repair to us to Ely House to see this business. Tomorrow next, we will for Ireland, and 'tis time I travel. And we create, in absence of ourself, our uncle York, Lord Governor of England, for he is just and always loved us well. Come on, our queen. Tomorrow must we part. Be merry, for our time of stay is short.
Well, Lord Ross, the Duke of Lancaster is dead. And living too, for now his son is Duke.
Well, in title, not in revenue. My heart is great, but it must break with silence and be disburdened with a liberal tongue.
Tends that thou would speak to the Duke of Hereford? If it be so, out with it boldly, man.
No good at all that I can do for him, unless you call it good to pity him,
bereft and gelded of his patrimony.
Now before God, to shame such wrongs are more. In him, a royal prince, and many more of noble blood in this declining land. The king is not himself, but basely led by flatterers. And what they will inform merely in aid against any of us all, that will the king severely prosecute. Against us, our lives, our children, and our heirs.
Commons have been filled with grievous taxes and quite lost their hearts. The nobles have been fined for ancient quarrels and quite lost their hearts. He hath not money for these Irish wars, his burdenous taxations notwithstanding, but by the robbing of the banished duke,
his noble kinsman, most the general kinsman. But Lord, we hear this for your content is seen. Yet see no shelter to abide his storm. We see the winds sit sore upon our sails, and yet we strike not, but securely perish.
We see the very wreck which we must suffer, and unavoided is the danger now, for suffering so the causes of our wreck.
Not so. Even through the hollow eyes of death, I spy life peering. But I dare not say or near the tidings of our comfort is.
Confident to speak, Northumberland?
My words are but as
false, therefore.
Be people.
And thus I have from Port of Blanca Bay in Brittany received intelligence that Harry Duke of Hereford, with 8 tall ships, 3,000 men of war, is making hither with all due expedience, and shortly means to touch our northern shores. Perhaps he had ere this, but stays upon the first departing of the king from Ireland. If then we shall shake off our slavish yoke, imp out our drooping country's broken wing, redeem from broken pawn the blemished crown, and make my majesty look like itself. Away with me and pause to Ravensburg. But if you faint as fearing to do so, stay and be secret, and myself will go.
To horse? To horse, urge doubts to them that fear.
Hold out my horse, and I will first be there.
Cut off my head with my brother. Gentlemen, will you go, Master Men? If I know how or which way to order these affairs, thus thrust disorderly into my hands, never believe me, both are my kinsmen. The one is my sovereign, whom both my oath and duty bids defend. The other again is my kinsman, whom the king hath wronged, whom conscience and my kindred bids to right. But somewhat we must do. Come, cousin, I'll dispose of you. Gentlemen, go muster up your men, and meet me presently at Barkley. I would to Flashy too, but time doth not permit. All is uneven, and everything is left at 6 and 7.
The wind sits fair for you to go to Ireland, but none returns. For us to levy power, proportionable to the enemy, is all impossible.
Besides, our nearness to the king in love is near the hate of those loving after the king.
And that's the wavering commons, for their love lies in their purses, and whoso empties them by so much fills their hearts with deadly hate.
Wherein the king stands generally condemned.
If judgment lie in them, then so do we, for we ever have been near the king.
Well, I will for refuge straight to Bristol Castle.
Thither will I with you. But little office the hateful commons will perform for us, except like curs, to tear us all to pieces. Will you go along with us?
No, I will to Wales to rouse the troops. Farewell, if half presages be not vain, we three here part, ne'er shall meet again.
That is your prize to beat back Bolingbroke!
Alas, poor Duke, the task he undertakes is numbering sands and drinking oceans dry, where one on his side fights thousands will fly. Farewell at once, for all, and ever.
But we may meet again.
I fear me never.
Therefore, personally, I lay my claim to my inheritance.
be too much abused.
It stands your grace upon to do him right. Base men by his endowments are made great.
My lord of England, let me tell you this. I have had feeling of my cousin's wrongs and labored all I could to do him right. But in this time to come, in braving arms, be his own power and cut out his way, to find out right with wrong it may not be. And you that do abet him in this time, cherish rebellion and are rebels all.
The noble duke has sworn his coming is but for his own, and for the right of that, we all have strongly sworn to grant him aid, and let him ne'er see joy that breaks that oath.
Well, well, I see the issue of these arms. I cannot mend it, I must needs confess, because my power is weak and all ill left. But if I could, by him that gave me life, I would attach you all and make you stoop unto the sovereign mercy of your king. But since I cannot, be it known to you, I will remain as neuter, so fare you well.
But we must win your grace to go with us to my father's castle, which they say is held by Bushy, Bagot, and their accomplices. The caterpillars of the Commonwealth, who I have sworn to weed and pluck away.
It may be I will go with you, but yet I'll pause, for I am loath to break our country's laws. Nor friends nor foes to me welcome you are. Things past redress, and now with me past care. Foreign clouds, eating the bitter bread of banishment. whilst you have fed upon my seigneuries, disparked my parks, and felled my forest woods. From my own windows, torn my household coat, raised out my interests, leaving me no sign, save men's opinions and my living blood, to show the world I am a gentleman! This and much more has more than twice on this condemns you to the dead. I order your permanency in this match.
More welcome is the stroke of death to me than Bolingbroke to England. Lord, farewell.
My comfort is to heaven will take our souls and plague injustice with the pains of hell.
Uncle, you say the queen is at your house. For God's sake, fairly let her be entreated. Tell her I send to her my kind commands. Take special care my greeting be delivered.
A gentleman of mine I have dispatched with letters of your love to her at large.
Thanks. Gentle Anna. Come, Lord. Away.
Stand upon my kingdom once again. Dear earth, I do salute thee with my hand. The rebels wound thee with their horses' hoofs. As a long-parted mother with her child plays fondly with her tears and smiles in meeting, so weeping, smiling, greet I thee, my earth. And do thee favors with my royal hands. Feed not thy sovereign's foe, my gentle earth, or with thy sweets comfort his ravenous sense. But let thy spiders that suck up thy venom and heavy-gated toads lie in their way, doing annoyance to the treacherous feet which with usurping steps do trample thee. Yield stinging nettles to mine enemies, and when they from thy bosom pluck a flower, guard it, I pray thee, with a lurking adder, whose double tongue may with a mortal touch throw death upon thy sovereign's enemies. Mock not my senseless conjuration, lords. This earth shall have a feeling, and these stones prove armed soldiers ere her native king shall falter under foul rebellion's arms.
Fear not, my lord. The power that made you king hath power to keep you king in spite of all.
He means, my lord, we are too remiss. While Bolingbroke, through our security, grows strong and great in substance and in power.
Discomfortable cousins, knowest thou not that when the searching eye of heaven is hid behind the globe that lights the lower world, then thieves and robbers range abroad unseen. But when from under this terrestrial ball he fires the proud tops of the eastern pines and darts his light through every guilty hole, then murderous treasons and detested sins, the cloak of night being plucked from off their backs, stand bare and naked, trembling at themselves. Not all the water in the rough, rude sea can wash the balm off from an anointed king. The breath of worldly men cannot oppose the deputy elected by the Lord. For every man that Bolingbroke hath pressed to lift shrewd steel against our golden crown,
God for his Richard hath in heavenly pay. A glorious angel. Then if angels fight, weak men must fall, for heaven still guards the right. Welcome, my lord. How far off lies your power?
One day too late, I fear me, lovely lord. I've clouded all the happy days on earth. Call back yesterday, did time return, and not shalt have 12,000 fighting men today, day, unhappy day, too late. Or close thy joys, friends, fortune, and thy state. For all the Welshmen here in Rome were dead, are gone to Bolingbroke, dispersed, and fled.
Comfort my liege, why looks your grace so pale?
Now the blood of 20,000 men did triumph in my face, and they are fled. Until so much blood hither come again, have I not reason to look pale and dead?
Comfort my liege, remember who you are.
I had forgot myself. Am I not king? Awake, thou cowering majesty, thou sleepest. Is not the king's name 20,000 names? Arm, arm, my name! A puny subject strikes at thy great glory. Look not to the ground, ye favourites of a king, are we not high? High be our thoughts! I know my uncle York hath power enough to serve our turn. But who goes here?
More health and happiness betide my liege that can my care tuning tongue deliver.
Mine ear is open and my heart prepared. The worst is worldly loss, thou canst unfold. Cry woe, destruction, ruin, and decay. The worst is death, and death will have his day.
God, am I that your highness is so armed to bear the tidings of calamity? Like an unseasonable stormy day, which makes the silver rivers drown their shores, as if the world were all dissolved to tears. So high above his limit swells the rage of Bolingbroke, covering your fearful land with hard, bright steel and hearts harder than steel. Against thy seat both young and old rebel, and all goes worse than I have heard tell.
Too well, thou tellst the tale so ill.
That rounds the mortal temples of a king.
keeps deaf his court. And there the antic sits, scoffing his state and grinning at his pomp, allowing him a breath, a little sea, to monarchize, be feared and kill with looks, infusing him with self and vain conceit, as if this flesh which walls about our life were brass impregnable, and humored thus comes out the last, and with a little pin bores through his castle wall, and farewell, king. Cover your heads, and mock not flesh and blood with solemn reverence. Throw away respect, tradition, form, and ceremonious duty. For you have but mistook me all this while. I eat with bread, like you. Feel want. Taste grief. Need friends. Subjected thus, how can you say to me I am a king?
My lord, wise men there sit and wail their woes, but presently prevent the ways to wail. Fear and be slain, no force can come to fight. Fight and die is death, destroying death. Where fearing, dying pays death, servile breath.
My father hath a power, inquire of him, and learn to make a body of a limb.
That chides me well, proud Bolingbroke, I come to change blows with me for our day of doom. This aching fit of fear is overblown. An easy task it is to win a home. Say, Scroope, where lies our uncle with his power? Speak sweetly, man, although thy looks be sour.
Then, judged by the complexion of the sky, the state and inclination of the day, so may you, by my dull and heavy eye, my tongue hath but a heavier tale to say. I play the torturer by small and small to lengthen out the worst that must be spoken. Your uncle York is joined with Bolingbroke, and all your northern castles yielded up, and all your southern gentlemen in arms upon his party.
Thou said enough. Beshrew thee, cousin, which didst lead me forth of that sweet way I was in to despair. What say you now? What comfort have we now? By heaven, I hate him everlastingly that bids me be of comfort anymore. Go to Flint Castle. There I'll pine away. A king, woe's slave, shall kingly woe obey. That power I have discard and let them go to ear the land that hath some hope to grow. For I have none. Let no man speak again toward to this, for counsel is but vain.
My lord, one word!
He does me double wrong, but wounds me with the flatteries of his tongue. Discharge my followers, bid them hence away, from Richard's night to Bolingbroke's fair day.
Against thy entrance.
Boy, why? Contains your key.
Yes, my good lord. I thought the tenant came, King Richard lies within the limits of your lining stone, and with him are the Lord of Merle, Sir Stephen Scroope, beside the clergyman of holy reverence, so we cannot learn.
What we like it is the Bishop of Carlisle.
No, my lord. Go to the ruins of that ancient castle. To a brazen trumpet, send the breath of party into his ruined ears, and thus deliver. Henry Bolingbroke, on both his knees, doth kiss King Richard's hand, and sends allegiance and true faith of heart to his most royal person, hither come, even at his feet, to lay my arms and power, provided that my banishment repealed and lands restored again be freely granted. If not, I'll use the advantage of my power and lay the summer's dust with showers of blood rained from the wounds of slaughtered English. The which, how far off from the mind of Bolingbroke it is, such crimson tempests should bedrench the fresh green lap of fair King Richard's land. My stooping duty tenderly shall show. Go signify as much. Methinks King Richard and myself should meet with no less terror than the elements of fire and water, when their thundering shock at meeting tears the cloudy cheeks of heaven. Be he the fire, I'll be the yielding water. The rage be his, whilst on the earth I reign. My waters on the earth are not on him. See, see, King Richard hath himself appear, as doth the blushing discontented sun from out the fiery portal of the east, when he perceives the envious clouds are bent to stain his glory and to stain the path of his bright passage to the Oxford.
Yet looks he like a king, behold his eye, as bright as is the eagle's lightens forth, controlling majesty, alack, alack for woe, that any harm should stay so fair a show.
Forget to pay their awful duty to our presence. If we be not, show us the hand of heaven that hath dismissed us from our stewardship. For well we know no hand of blood and bone can grant the sacred handle of our scepter, unless he do profane, steal, or usurp. And though you think that all, as you have done, have torn their souls by turning them from us, and we are barren and bereft of friends, yet know, my master, God omnipotent, is mustering in his clouds on our behalf armies of pestilence, and they shall strike your children yet unborn and unbegot, that lift your vassal hands against my head and threat the glory of my precious crown. Tell Bolingbroke, for yon methinks he stands, that every stride he makes upon my land is dangerous treason. He is come to open the purple testament of bleeding war. But ere the crown he look for live in peace, 10,000 bloody crowns of mother's sons shall ill become the flower of England's face, change the complexion of her maid pale peace to scarlet indignation.
The King of Heaven forbid our Lord the King should so with civil and uncivil arms be rushed upon. Thy thrice noble cousin, Harry Bolingbroke, doth humbly kiss thy hand. And by the honourable tomb he swears, his coming hither had no further scope than for his lineal royalties and to beg enfranchisement immediate on his knees. This swears he as he is a prince is just, and as I am a gentleman, I credit him.
Northumberland, say thus the king returns. His noble cousin is right welcome hither, and all the number of his fair demands shall be accomplished without contradiction. With all the gracious utterance thou hast, speak to his gentle hearing kind commends. We do debase ourselves, cousin, do we not? To look so poorly and to speak so fair. Shall we call back Northumberland and send defiance to the traitor and so die? No good, my lord. Let's fight with gentle words. If time lent friends, and friends their helpful swords.
O God, that e'er this tongue of mine, that laid the sentence of dread banishment on yon proud man, should take it off again, with words of sooth. Oh, that I were as great as is my grief, or lesser than my name, or that I could forget what I have been, or not remember what I must be now. Swell'st thou, proud heart, I'll give thee scope to beat, since foes have scope to beat both thee and me.
Northumberland comes back from Bolingbroke.
What must the king do now? Must he submit? The king shall do it. Must he be deposed? The king shall be contented. Must he lose the name of king? A god's name. Let it go. I'll give my jewels for a set of beads, my gorgeous palace for a hermitage, my gay apparel for an almsman's gown, my figured goblets for a dish of wood, my sceptre for a palmer's walking staff, my subjects for a pair of carved saints, and my large kingdom for a little grave. A little, little grave. An obscure grave. Or I'll be buried in the king's highway, some way of common trade where subjects' feet may hourly trample on their sovereign's head, for on my heart they tread now whilst I live, and buried once by not upon my head. O world, thou weeps, my tender-hearted cousin, we'll make foul weather with despised dews. Our sighs and they shall watch the summer corn and make a dearth in this revolting land. Or shall we play the wantons with our woes, and make some silly match with shedding tears, as thus to drop them still upon one place, till they have fretted us a pair of graves within the earth, and therein laid there lies two kinsmen dig their graves with weeping eyes. Would not this ill do well? Well, well, I see. I talk but idly, and you laugh at me. Most mighty prince, my lord Northumberland, what says King Bolingbroke? Will his majesty give Richard leave to live till Richard die?
My lord, in the base court he doth attend. To speak to you, may it please you to come down.
Down, down I come, like glistering phaeton wanting the manage of unruly jades. In the base court? Base court! Where kings grow base to come at traitors' calls and do them grace in the base court. Come down. Down, court! Down, king! For night owls shriek where mounting larks should sing.
What says his majesty?
Sorrow and grief of heart makes him speak fondly like a frantic man. Yet he is come.
Stand all apart, and pay fair duty to his majesty. My gracious lord.
Fair cousin, you debase your princely knee to make the base earth proud with kissing it. Me rather had my heart might feel your love than my unpleased eye see your courtesy. Up, cousin, up. Your heart is up, I know. Thus high, at least.
although your knee be low.
My gracious lord, I come but for mine own.
Your own is yours, and I am yours at all.
So far be mine, my most redoubted lord, that my true service shall deserve your love.
Well you deserve, they well deserve to have, that know the strongest and surest way to get. Uncle, give me your hands. Nay, dry your eyes. Tears show their love, but want their remedies. Cousin, I am too young to be your father, though you are old enough to be my heir. What you will have, I'll give, and willing to. For do we must what force will have us do. Set on towards London, cousin, is it so?
Yea, my good lord.
Then I must not say no.
Showing us in a model of firm estate, when our seawall garden, the whole land is full of weeds, our fairest flowers chalked up, our fruit trees all upturned, our hedges ruined, our knots disordered, and our wholesome herbs swarming with caterpillars.
All thy peas. He that hath suffered this disordered spring hath now himself met with the fall of leaf. The weeds which his broad spreading leaves did shelter are plucked up, root and all, by Bolingbroke. I mean the favourites of the king. Bushy, Green.
What? Are they dead?
Yeah, and Bolingbroke had seized the wasteful king. Oh, what pity is it that he had not so trimmed and dressed his land as we this garden. We at time of year do wound the bark, the skin of our fruit trees. This being overproud with sap and blood, with too much riches, it confounded itself. Had he done so to great and growing men, they might have lived to bear, and he to taste the fruits of labour. Superfluous branches we lop away, that bearing boughs may live. Had he done so, himself had borne the crown, which waste of idle hours had quite thrown down.
What think you then the king shall be deposed?
Depressed he is already, and deposed he will be. Letters came last night to a dear friend of the good Duke of York's that bear black tidings.
Oh, I'm pressed to death through want of speaking. Thou, old Adam's likeness set to press this garden, how darest thy harsh, rude tongue sound this unpleasing news? What Eve, what serpent hath suggested thee to make a second fall of cursed man? Why dost thou say King Richard is deposed? Darest thou, thou little better thing than earth, divine his downfall? Say where, when, and how? Canst thou by this ill tiding speak, thou wretch?
Pardon me, madam, little joy have I to breathe this news, yet what I say is true. King Richard, he is in the mighty hold of Bolingbroke, their fortunes both are weighed. In your large scale is nothing but himself, but in the balance of great Bolingbroke, besides himself, are all the English peers. And with that odds, he weighs King Richard down. Host you to London and you will find it so. I speak no more than everyone doth know.
Nimble mischance that art so light of foot. Doth not thy embassage belong to me? No, my last, thou knows it. Come, lady, go. To meet at London, London's king and all. What was I born to this, that my sad look should grace the triumph of great Bolingbroke? Gardener, for telling me these news of woe, pray God the plants thou graft may never grow.
Poor queen, so that thy state might be no worse, I would my skill were subject to thy curse. Here did she fall a tear, here in this place, I'll set a bank of rue, sour herb of grace. Rue, even for root, here shortly shall be seen, in the remembrance of a weeping queen.
Fitzwater, I do remember well the very time O'Meara
Engage it to the trial if thou darest. Besides, I heard the banished Mowbray say that thou, Merle, didst send two of thy men to execute the noble duke at Calais.
Some honest Christian trust me with the gage. That Mowbray liest, here do I throw down this, if he may be repealed to try his honour.
Your differences shall all rest under gage till Mowbray be repealed. Repealed he shall be. And though our enemy, restored again to all his lands and seigneuries, when he is returned against O'Merle, we will enforce his trial.
That honourable day shall ne'er be seen. Many a time hath banished Mowbray fought for Jesu Christ in glorious Christian field, and toiled with works of war, retired himself to Italy, and there at Venice gave his body to that pleasant country's earth, and his pure soul unto his captain Christ, under whose colours he had fought so long.
Why, Bishop? Is Mowbray dead?
As surely as I live, my lord.
Sweet grace conduct his sweet soul to the bosom of good old Abraham. Lords appellants, your differences shall all rest under gage till we assign you to your days of trial.
Great Duke of Lancaster, I come to thee from plume-plucked Richard, who with willing soul adopts thee heir, and his high scepter yields to the possession of thy royal hand. Ascend his throne, descending now from him, and long live Henry IV of that name.
In God's name, I will ascend the regal throne.
Marry, God forbid! Worst in this royal presence may I speak, yet best beseeming me to speak the truth. Would God that any in this noble presence were enough noble to be upright judge of noble Richard? What subject gives sentence on his king? And who sits here that is not Richard's subject? And shall the figure of God's majesty be judged by subject and inferior breath, and he himself not present? Oh, forfend it God, that in a Christian climate souls refined should show so heinous, black, obscene a deed. My lord of Hereford here, whom you call king, is a foul traitor to proud Hereford's king. And if you crown him, let me prophesy, the blood of English shall manure the ground, and in this seat of peace tumultuous wars shall kin with kin and kind with kind confound. Prevent it, resist it, let it not be so, lest child's children cry against you woe.
Well have you argued, sir, and for your pains of capital treason we arrest you here. My Lord Fitzwater, be it your charge to keep him safely till his day of trial. May it please you, Lord, to grant the commons' suit.
Fetch hither Richard, that in common view he may surrender, so we may proceed without suspicion.
I will be his conduct.
O'Merle, procure your sureties for your days of answer. Little are we beholding to your love. And little looked for at your helping hands.
Alack, why am I sent for to a king? Before I have shook off the regal thoughts wherewith I reigned, I hardly yet have learned to insinuate, flatter, bow, and bend my knee. Give sorrow leave a while to tutor me to this submission. Yet I well remember the favors of these men. Were they not mine? Did they not sometime cry all hail to me? So Judas did to Christ, but he in 12 found truth in all but one, I in 12,000 none. God save the king! Will no man say amen? Am I both priest and clerk? Well then, amen. God save the king, although I be not he. And yet amen, if heaven do think in me. To do what service am I sent for hither?
To do that office of thine own good will, which tired majesty did make thee offer,
the resignation of thy state and crown to Henry Bolingbroke.
Give me the crown. Here, cousin, seize the crown. Here, cousin. On this side my hand, and on that side yours. Now is this golden crown like a deep well that owes two buckets, filling one another? The emptier ever dancing in the air, the other down, unseen and full of water. That bucket down and full of tears am I, drinking my griefs whilst you mount up on high.
I thought you had been contented to resign.
My crown I am, yet still my griefs are mine. You may my glories and my state depose, but not my griefs, still am I king of those.
Part of your cares you give me with the crown.
Your cares set up do not pluck my cares down. The cares I give I have, though given away. They tend the crown, yet still with me they stay.
Are you contented to resign the crown?
Aye. No. No. I, for I must nothing be. Therefore, no, no, for I resign to thee. Now mark me how I will undo myself. Give this heavy weight from off my head, the pride of kingly sway from out my heart. With mine own tears I wash away my balm, with mine own hands I give away my crown. With mine own tongue deny my sacred state. With mine own breath, release all duty's rights. All pomp and majesty I do forswear. My manors, rents, revenues I forego. My acts, decrees, and statutes I deny. God pardon all oaths that are broke to me. God keep all vows unbroke that swear to me. Make me that nothing have, with nothing grieved. And thou with all pleased that hast all achieved. Long mayst thou live in Richard's seat to sit. And soon lie Richard in an earthly pit. God save King Harry, unkinged Richard says. And send him many years of sunshine days. What more remains?
None but that you read. These accusations and these grievous crimes committed by your person and your followers against the profit and state of this land, that by confessing them the souls of men may deem you are worthily deposed.
Must I do so, and must I ravel out my weaved up folly, gentle Northumberland? If thy offences were upon record, would it not shame thee in so fair a troop to read a lecture of them? Nay, if thou wouldst, there shouldst thou find one heinous article containing the deposing of a king. Nay, all of you that stand and look upon, whilst that my wretchedness doth bait myself, though some of you with Pilate wash your hands, showing an outward pity, yet you Pilates have here delivered me to my sour cross, and water cannot wash away your sin.
My lord, dispatch, read all these articles.
Mine eyes are full of tears, I cannot see. And yet salt water blinds them not so much, but they can see a sort of traitors here. Nay, if I turn mine eyes upon myself, I find myself a traitor with the rest. For I have given here my soul's consent to undeck the pompous body of the king, made glory base and sovereignty a slave, proud majesty, a subject state, a peasant.
My lord,
no lord of thine, thou haught insulting man, nor no man's lord, I have no name. No title. No, not that name was given me at the font. But 'tis usurped, alack the heavy day, that I have worn so many winters out, and know not now what name to call myself. Oh, that I were a mockery king of snow, standing before the sun of Bolingbroke to melt myself away in water drops. Good king, great king, and yet not greatly good. And if my word be sterling yet in England, let it command a mirror hither straight, that it may show me what a face I have, since it is bankrupt of his majesty.
Go, some of you, fetch a looking glass.
Read o'er this paper while the glass doth come.
Fiend, thou torment'st me ere I come to hell.
Urge it no further, my lord Northumberland.
The commons will not then be satisfied.
They shall be satisfied. I'll read enough when I do see the very book indeed, where all my sins are writ, and that's myself. Give me the glass, and therein will I read.
No deeper wrinkles yet?
Hath sorrow struck so many blows upon this face of mine, and made no deeper wounds, oh, flattering glass. Like to my followers in prosperity, thou dost beguile me. Was this face the face that every day under his household roof did keep 10,000 men? Was this the face that like the sun did make beholders wink? Was this the face that faced so many follies? And was at last outfaced by Bolingbroke? A brittle glory shineth in this face. As brittle as the glory. Is the face. For there it is, cracked in 100 shivers. Mark, silent king, the moral of this sport, how soon my sorrow hath destroyed my face.
The shadow of your sorrow hath destroyed the shadow of your face.
Say that again. The shadow of my sorrow. Ha, let's see. 'Tis very true, my grief lies all within. And these external manners of laments are merely shadows to the unseen grief that swells with silence in the tortured soul. There lies the substance. And I thank thee, King, for thy great bounty that not only gives to me cause to wail, but teachest me the way how to lament the cause. I'll beg one boon, and then be gone and trouble you no more. Shall I obtain it?
Name it. Fair cousin.
Fair cousin?
I am better than a king.
For when I was a king, my flatterers were then but subjects. Being now subject, I have a king here to my flatterer. Being so great, I have no need to beg.
Yet ask.
And shall I have?
You shall.
Then give me leave to go.
Whither?
Whither you will. So I were from your sights.
Convey him to the tower.
Oh, good. convey. Conveyors, are you all that rise thus nimbly by a true king's fall?
On Wednesday next, we solemnly lay down our coronation. Lords, prepare yourselves.
A woeful pageant have we here beheld.
The woes to come. The children yet unborn shall feel this day as sharp to them as Thor.
O holy clergyman, is there no plot to rid the realm of this pernicious blot?
I see your brow is full of discontent, your heart of sorrow, and your eyes of tears. Come home with me to supper, and I lay a plot shall show us all a merry day.
And he and I shall keep a league till death.
What? Is my Richard, both in shape and mind, transformed and weakened? Had Bolingbroke deposed thy intellect, had he been in thy heart? The lion dying thrusteth forth his paw, and wounds the earth, if nothing else, with rage. To be o'erpowered, and wilt thou pupil like? Take thy correction mildly, kiss the rod, and fawn on rage with base humility, which art a lion and a king of beasts.
A king of beasts, indeed. If aught but beasts, I had been still a happy king of men. Good sometime, queen, prepare thee hence for France. Think I am dead, and that even here thou takest as from my deathbed thy last living leave. In winter's tedious night, sit by the fire with good old folks, and let them tell thee tales of woeful ages long ago but hid. And ere thou bid good night to quit their griefs, tell thou the lamentable tale of me, and send the heroes weeping to their beds.
My lord, the mind of Bolingbroke is changed. You must do Pomfret, not into the tower. Madam, there's an order claimed for you.
Northumberland, thou ladder wherewithal the mounting Bolingbroke ascends my throne. The time shall not be many hours of age, more than it is, ere foul sin gathering head shalt break into corruption. Thou shalt think, though he divide the realm and give thee half, it is too little helping him to all. And he shall think that thou, which know'st the way to plant unrightful kings, wilt know again, being ne'er so little urged another way to pluck him headlong from the usurped throne. The love of wicked men converts to fear, that fear to hate, and hate turns one or both to worthy danger and deserved death.
My guilt be on my head and there an end. Take leave and part, for you must part forthwith.
Doubly divorced, bad men, you violate a twofold marriage, twixt my crown and me, and then betwixt me and my married wife.
Let me unkiss the oath twixt thee and me. Yet, not so, for with a kiss 'twas made. Part us, Northumberland, I toward the north, where shivering cold and sickness pines the clime. my wife to France, from whence set forth in pomp, she came adorned hither like sweet May. Sent back like Halimus or shortest of day.
Must we be divided? Must we part?
My hand from hand, my love, and heart from heart.
Banish us both and send the king with me.
That was some love, but little policy.
Then whither he goes, thither let me go.
Come in wooing sorrow, let's be brief, since wedding it there is such length in grief. One kiss shall stop our mouths and dumbly part. Thus give I mine, and thus take I thy heart.
Give me mine own again. 'Twere no good part to take on me to keep and kill thy heart. Now I have mine own again, be gone. But I may strive to kill it with a groan.
We may grow wanton with this fond delay. Once more, adieu. The rest let sorrow say.
Slow but stately pace kept on his course, whilst all tongues cried, God save thee, Bolingbroke! You would have thought the very windows spake. So many greedy looks of young and old through casements darted their desiring eyes upon his visage, and that all the walls with painted imagery had said at once, Jesu preserve thee, welcome, Bolingbroke! Whilst he, from the one side to the other, turning, bareheaded, lower than his proud steed's neck, bespake them thus, I thank you, countrymen. And thus still doing, thus he passed along.
Alack, poor Richard, where rode he the whilst?
As in a theatre, the eyes of men, after a well-graced actor leaves the stage, are idly bent on him that enters next, thinking his prattle to be tedious. Even so, or with much more contempt, men's eyes did scowl on gentle Richard. No man cried, God save him. No joyful tongue gave him his welcome home, but dust was thrown upon his sacred head, which with such gentle sorrow he shook off, that had not God for some high purpose steeled the hearts of men, they must perforce have melted. But heaven hath a hand in these events, to whose high will we bound our calm content. To Bolingbroke are we sworn subjects now, whose state and honour eye for eye allow.
Here comes my son, O'Mell!
O'Mell that was, but that is lost for being Richard's friend. And madam, you must call him Rutland now. I am in Parliament pledge for his truth and lasting fealty to the new-made king.
Welcome, my son! Who are the violets now that strew the green lap of the new-come spring?
Madam, I know not, nor I greatly care not. God knows I had as lief be none as one.
Well, bear you well in this new spring of time, lest you be cropped before you come to prime. What news from Oxford? All those jousts and triumphs?
For aught I know, my lord, they do.
You will be there, I know.
If God prevent it not, I purpose so.
What seal is that hangs without thy bosom? Yeah? Look'st thou pale? Let me see the writing.
My lord, 'tis nothing.
No matter then who see it. I will be satisfied. Let me see the writing.
I do beseech your grace to pardon me. It is a matter of small consequence, which for some reasons I would not have seen.
Which for some reason, sir, I mean to see. I fear!
What should you fear? 'Tis nothing but some bond he's entered into for gay apparel gainst the triumph day.
Bound to himself? What did he with a bond that he is bound to? Wife, thou art a fool. Boy, let me see the writing.
I do beseech you. Pardon me, I may not show it.
I will be satisfied. Let me see it. I say! Treason. Foul treason.
Villain! Traitor! Slave!
What is the matter, my lord?
Ho! Who is within there? Saddle my horse!
God, for his mercy, what treachery is here?
Why, what is it, my lord?
Give me my boots, I say! Saddle my horse!
Now, by my honor, by my life, by my troth, I will appease the villain.
Why, what is it, my lord?
Peace, foolish woman!
I will not peace! What is the matter, Omal?
Good mother, be content, it is no more. Then my poor life must answer.
Thy life answer?
Give me my boots! I will up to the king!
Oh, why, York, what wilt thou do? Wilt thou not hide the trespass of thine own? Have we more sons than we like to have? Is not my teeming day drunk up with time? And wilt thou pluck my fair son from mine age and rob me of a happy mother's name? Is he not like thee? Is he not thine own?
Thou fond, mad woman, wilt thou conceal this dark conspiracy? A dozen of them here had taken the sacrament and interchangeably set down their hands to kill the king at Oxford.
Oh, he shall be none. We'll keep him here, then what is that to him?
Away, fond woman, were he 20 times. My son, I would appeach him.
Hadst thou groaned for him as I have done, thou wouldst be more pitiful. But now I know thy mind. Thou dost suspect that I have been disloyal to thy bed, and that he is a bastard, not thy son. Oh, sweet York, sweet husband, be not of that mind. He is as like thee as a man may be, not like to me or any of my kin, yet I love him.
Make way, unruly woman.
After, Omal! Mount thee upon his horse, spur post, and get before him to the king, and beg thy pardon ere he do accuse thee. I'll not be long behind. And never will I rise up from the ground till Bolingbroke have pardoned thee. Away, be gone!
Excuse this deadly blot in thy digressing son.
My honour lives when his dishonour dies, or my shamed life in his dishonour lies. Thou killst me in his life, giving him breath. The traitor lives, the true man's put to death.
What, ho, my liege? For God's sake, let me in.
What shrill voice, suppliant, makes this eager cry? The beggar and the king. My dangerous cousin, let your mother in. I know she's come to pray for your foul sin.
Oh, king, believe not this hard-hearted man, love loving not itself, none other can.
Thou frantic woman, what makes thou here? Shall thy old duns once more a traitor air?
Sweet York, be patient. Hear me, gentle liege.
Good aunt, rise up.
Not yet, I be beseech. Forever will I walk upon my knees till thou give joy, until thou bid me joy, by pardoning Rutland, my transgressing boy.
Unto my mother's prayers I bend my knee.
Against them both my true George bend his knee. Ill mayest thou thrive if thou grant any grace.
Please, he in earnest, look upon his face. His eyes do drop no tears, his brethren jest. His words come from his mouth, ours from our breast. He prays but vaguely and would be denied. We pray with heart and soul and all beside. His weary joints would gladly rise, I know. Our knees shall kneel till to the ground they grow. His prayers are for the false hypocrisy, ours of true zeal and deep integrity. Our prayers do I pray his, then let them have that mercy which true prayer ought to have.
Good and rise up.
Nay, do not say stand up, say pardon first and afterwards stand up. I never long to hear a word till now. Say pardon, king, let pity teach thee how.
I pardon you. As God will pardon me.
Oh, happy vantage of an ailing knee! Yet am I sick for fear, speak it again.
I pardon him with all my heart.
A god on earth thou art!
But for our trusty bishop and all the rest of that consorted crew, destruction straight shall dog them at the heels, uncle. Help to organize several powers to Oxford or wheresoe'er these traitors be. They shall not live upon this earth, I swear, but I will have them if I once know them. Uncle, farewell. And cousin too, adieu. Your mother well hath prayed and prove you true.
Come, my old son. I pray God make thee.
Mark the king what words he spake. Have I no friend will rid me of this living fear? Was it not so?
These words, very words.
Have I no friend, quoth he spake it twice, and urged it twice together, did he not?
He did.
Speaking it, he wistly looked on me. And who should say I would thou wert the man that would divorce this terror from my heart? Meaning the king of Pomfret, come let's go. I am the king's friend and will rid his foe.
Oh,
I have been studying how I may compare this prison where I live unto the world. And for because the world is populous, and here is not a creature but myself, I cannot do it. Yet I'll hammer it out. My brain I'll prove the female to my soul. My soul the father, and these two beget a generation of still breeding thoughts. And these same thoughts people this little world in humours like the people of this world, for no thought is contented. The better sort, as thoughts of things divine, are intermixed with scruples, and do set the word itself against the word. As thus, come, little ones. And then again, it is as hard to come as for a camel to thread the postern of a small needle's eye. Thoughts tending to ambition, they do plot unlikely wonders how these vain, weak nails may tear a passage through the flinty ribs of this hard world, my ragged prison walls, and for they cannot die in their own pride. Thoughts tending to content flatter themselves that they are not the first of fortune's slaves, nor shall not be the last. Like silly beggars who, sitting in the stocks, refuge their shame that many have and others must sit there, and in this thought they find a kind of ease, bearing their own misfortune on the back of such as have before endured the like. Thus play I in one person many people, and none contented. Sometimes am I king. Then treasons make me wish myself a beggar, and so I am. Then crushing penury persuades me I was better when a king. Then am I kinged again, and by think that I am unkinged by Bolingbroke and straight and nothing. But whate'er I be, nor I nor any man that but man is, with nothing shall be pleased till he be eased with being nothing. Music, do I hear?
Keep time. How sour sweet music is when time is broke and no proportion kept.
So is it in the music of men's lives. And here have I the daintiness of ear to check time broke in a disordered string. But for the concord of my state and time, had not an ear to hear my true time broke. My thoughts are minutes, and with sighs they jar. Their watches are unto mine eyes the outward watch, whereto my finger, like a dial's point, is pointing still and cleansing them from tears.
This music mads me, let it sound no more. For though it have held madmen to their wits, with me it seems it will make wise men mad. Yet blessing on his heart that gives it. For 'tis a sign of love, and love to Richard is a strange brooch in this all-hating world.
My lord, will it please you to fall too?
Place not at first, as thou art wont.
My lord, I dare not. Sir Pierce of Exton, who lately came from the king, commands the contrary.
The devil take Henry of Lancaster and thee. Patience is stale.
and I am weary of it!
Consorted traitors that sought at Oxford thy dire overthrow.
Thy pains, my lord of Ross, we've not forgot. Right noble is thy merit. Well, I wot.
The grand conspirators, with cloud of conscience and sour melancholy, had yielded up their bodies to the graves. But here is Caroline, living to abide thy kingly doom and sentence of his pride.
Carlyle, here is thy doom. Choose out some secret place, some reverent room, more than thou hast, and with it joy thy life. So as thou livest in peace, die free from strife. For though mine enemy thou hast ever been, high
sparks of honour
in thee have I seen.
Great King! Within this coffin I present, thy living fear herein all breathless lies. The mightiest of thy greatest enemies, Richard of Bordeaux, by me hither brought.
Exton, I thank thee not, for thou hast wrought a deed of slander with thy fatal hand upon my head and all this famous land.
By your own mouth, my lord, did I this deed.
They love not poison that do poison need, nor do I thee. For though I wished him dead, I hate the murderer, love him murdered. The guilt of conscience take thee for thy labour, but never my good word, nor princely favour. With Cain, go wander in the shades of night, and never show thy head by day nor night!
Friends, I protest, my soul is full of woe, that blood should sprinkle me to make me grow.
Mourn with me for what I do lament, and put on sullen, black incontinent. I'll make a voyage to the Holy Land to wash this blood from off my guilty hand.